have become much more visible in metal. Not only are they fronting some of the world's biggest metal bands, but they are now mastering the once male-dominated technique of extreme guttural vocals.
Like you meet, when you go on the festival, you meet lots of women nowadays who are in the band, and so it's not that boys club anymore. And I think boys are happy about that as well, because I mean, it must have been a bit boring. I mean, like, it's just guys, sweaty, ugly guys around you. Nowadays it's, you know, it's a couple of females. It kind of loosens us up, you know? I get a lot of mails from young girls saying, well, I saw you live and that was just great to see that a woman can pull that off, and I just joined a band now and I want to do that myself.
Is having kind of a tough persona on stage, is that important to you?
Yeah, because I am tough on stage. You know, I feel very strong on stage and I want to give that to the people in front of that stage, that you can just have a lot of strength and power and just want to give it to these people and they take a bit of that home.
Being called sexist in a boys' club is one thing, but what about metal being called blasphemous? I'm going to talk to Ronnie James Dio again. We really hit it off at the Wacken Festival, so he invited me over to his house to continue our conversation. Like many metal artists, Ronnie's music is full of religious symbolism, yet his message is often at odds with these religions, especially Christianity. So I'm curious to hear what Ronnie has to say about metal's religious obsession.
You're a takeoff!
Do you know if anyone holds a patent to this?
To that? No, I don't think anyone does. You can just go like this.
There you go then, Phil. I think it's time to do a Gene Simmons. Because I understood that Gene had found out that that OJ, as in orange juice, had never been patented before, so he patented it. So every time anyone mentions OJ, not only, I don't know about OJ Simpson, but orange juice, that he gets some money from it. Which seems so Gene-ish to me, you know, because he's so brilliant at that. He's just absolutely brilliant.
Yeah. I'm interested to get your perspective on how religion has played a part in the music that you've made.
I was always afraid as a kid of the nuns, you know, the big penguins that were going to like smack you in the head with a ruler, which is what they always did anyway. Or the fact that, you know, if you do something wrong, you're going to go to hell and, you know, you're going to suffer terribly. And I'm going, whoa, I mean, give me a break here. What's going on? So that's why for me the whole world is heaven and hell. That song is about that, the fact that we, in my mind, we live in heaven, we live in hell. God and the devil are inherent in each of us, and it's our choice to make. You can take the road to good and take the road to bad.
If there wasn't Christianity, we wouldn't have metal as we know it. Religion is really crucial to it. Most of the creators in metal, at least in metal's first several eras, were raised religiously.
Many years ago when we first started, somebody gave us some crosses and said, these will protect you. And we never ever went anywhere without a cross on, you know. I've never been on stage even to this day without a cross. And it's become the symbol of the band for all over. We've got crosses everywhere. I've got them all over my guitars. We've got them on stage. We've got them one place or another. There's a cross.
Heavy metal has pretty much, from the dawn of the genre, been associated with Satanism. And while Black Sabbath sung principally about Satan being something to be scared of, you know, some of this stuff could almost be described as a sort of Christian sentiment. The fans, however, wanted a satanic band, and eventually commercial pressures meant that Black Sabbath exploited this kind of connection between them and demonic imagery and satanic ideas.
Of course, we got a lot of flack for it from everybody else because, you know, there was things said about us being devil worshippers and God knows what else, you know. One particular thing that happened here in Europe was the church really tried to stop us from playing in this town. Whatever town it was, escapes me now. And we didn't, they actually did manage to stop us from playing. They banned the show. And the church burnt down. Nothing to do with us, but the church burnt down. But, of course, then it was to do with us. They sort of tried to turn it and it was our fault, you know. I think when we used to use crosses on stage on fire and stuff like that, probably didn't help.
Who cannot think of Black Sabbath without at least seeing one upside down cross? Who cannot think of Slayer without seeing a pentagram? You know, it's visually, it kind of ties you to a certain band, to a certain sound. It's cool, you know, and I don't think any of the people that use them actually want Satan to rule the world. You know, it's just something that enhances the experience for people.
The Satanism that you see is not Satanism. It's some kind of, you know, it's some kind of caricature Satanism. Real Satanism wouldn't be. If you're looking for Satanism, first of all, you don't look to rock and roll. A bunch of kids running around playing loud guitars and going like that. That's Halloween. Daring the flesh of the weak, tender child, spurting my lord of the meek and the mild. I think my
pride in your neck as you dream. I am God's lord of the vampires. When I first heard this band, Venom, I wasn't thinking Halloween. I thought they were truly satanic. And I wasn't the only one.
I remember, for me personally, Venom just scared the shit out of me when I first heard it. I actually refused to buy those records because I was scared. I mean, I literally was scared that I was doing something wrong. It was, like, so extreme. And now, of course, anyone seeing this video, looking at me as the guy that signed all these bands thinking he was scared of Venom, you know, they're gonna wet their pants. But it was a different thing back then. Like, this was unheard of. That shit was really, really, truly disturbing and scary when it came out. And look how big Venom got because of it. It's a way for bands to become popular. Extremes always sell.
Although Venom and other early satanic metal bands used Satan to shock people, Slayer's lyrics directly attacked Christianity. And as a teenage boy, how could you not get excited by album titles like Hell Awaits, Haunting the Chapel, and Rain and Blood? Slayer was a leader of the thrash metal movement, which drew on influences from the new wave of British heavy metal, punk, and hardcore. Along with the world's biggest metal band, Metallica, they introduced a new level of speed and intensity to the genre and were known for using graphic lyrics about war and religion.
I like to take pot shots at religion because I think it's the biggest brainwashing thing that is totally acceptable in America and probably most every place else in the world. I think it's a load of shit.
Tom, another well-tread path with you is your Christian background.
Yeah.
And the juxtaposition with your music.
Catholic.
What place do your personal beliefs have in Slayer?
I consider what we do art, right? And it's art can be a reflection of society. You know what I mean? And we're picking up the dark reflections. You know, and that's what we're reflecting. But evil's everywhere, man. Everybody's got it. It sits really deep in everybody. Some people can't control it as much as others. But I think it's there. Regardless of whatever fucking religion you believe in, whatever it is you feel is right, everybody knows what's wrong. Everybody knows that there's wrong things. They're just things you do not do. And the people that don't understand that or don't believe that, then they're not really connected with themselves spiritually. It doesn't matter what the fuck you believe. Girl, she's a devil tied, compelled to leave your
How does it fit in?
How does it fit in?
To the
he doesn't hate. He doesn't. God doesn't hate. It's a great fucking title. When they wanted to make that an album title, I was like, God damn, that's fucking really good. I think it'll fucking piss a lot of people off. God for me, with actual war.
That want to be the biggest badasses pick the most badass subjects. It's not that these people believe in this stuff, it's just, you know, it's a cool imagery that goes along with music. And, you know, some people do believe in it, you know. I'm not going to deny that that the Norwegian bands are real. I mean, they've proven they're real by their actions.
Okay, so Venom and Slayer aren't real Satanists. But many fans, including me, wonder if the Norwegian black metal bands are the real thing. So I've come to Norway, an isolated country in Northern Europe. 87% of Norway's population belongs to the Lutheran State Church. And yet, strangely, Norway's biggest cultural export is satanic black metal.
We're filming a documentary. It's a documentary on heavy metal music.
Well, first of all, we told him we were doing a documentary on the history of metal, and he said, black metal.
Black
metal. They know their metal here in Norway, let me say.
Like thrash, black metal evolved from punk and the new wave of British heavy metal, with additional theatrical elements borrowed from shock rock. Its sound is raw, yet it is also epic and atmospheric, like punk rock meets Wagner dressed as Alice Cooper. My journey takes me on an overnight train ride from the capital city Oslo to Bergen, a small town on the fjords of the country's west coast. I'm here to talk to people linked to a string of incidents involving members of the Norwegian black metal scene and some of the country's oldest churches.
Rasmussen, I am an assistant minister of this church, Åsane Church in Bergen, Norway. I have been here for 3.5 years when suddenly, the night before Christmas Eve, I received a call from one of my colleagues and he told me, the church is on fire. And I fell into shivers right there in my bed and I dressed to go to the scene. And coming to the church, it was all flames. The firemen were trying to do their best to contain the damage. And we were there, the staff, looking at the flames, and the smell was everywhere, acrid and pungent. And the tower was still up when we arrived, but after some time, maybe half an hour, it fell heavily to the ground. This was a great loss, not just to us personally, but really to the whole community. This church had been standing here for nearly 200 years, and I saw quite a lot of sad faces. It was not a happy Christmas at all.
I satanistmiljøet i Oslo er det nå frykt for nye drap etter drapet på den 25 år.